In this screencast, we'll take a look at how the selection of your controller type in the PID family can influence the final steady state value of your process due to a set point change. So we've provided a block diagram for a generic feedback control system, the first order process being controlled by a particular PID family controller. The dynamics of the process are slow enough since the dynamics of the sensor transmitter and the valve can be assumed to be negligible. It can be assumed there are no disturbances present in the process, hence why there's no disturbance value seen in our block diagram. So what we're going to look at here is the offset that occurs if the set point of the controlled variable is instantaneously increased by magnitude M4. We'll look at a P-only controller and a PI controller. What we'll first do is evaluate what our blocks are. So here, we're told that the process is a first-order transfer function, so that we'll write it here as Kp over tau s plus 1. And we're told that the valve and the sensor transmitter are much faster than the dynamics are much faster than the process, which is another way of saying that the time dynamics are negligible. So therefore, we'll just have a gain for the valve and a gain for the transmitter. For the controller, we're given that we have a P-only controller and a PI controller. So for the P-only controller, we'll be looking at KC. And for a PI control, we'll be looking at KC times 1 plus 1 over tau IS. And these are the transfer functions for a P-only and a PI controller, respectively. So the problem is asking us to find the offset. What the offset represents is the value of the set point of the variable y minus the value of y as time goes to infinity when all the time dynamics have been settled out. The goal here is to have an offset that is equal to zero, because in this case here, if I change my set point by 3 degrees Celsius, I'm going to want my output variable changed by that exact same amount, because that is the value I want. If I have a set point change of magnitude m, that would again say, like, for example, if I'm increasing the temperature from 80 to 85 degrees Celsius, the change that I'm seeing here would be 5 degrees, or in this case, the magnitude of the step change, m. Be important to note here that we are doing this analysis based in the deviation variables for simplicity. So in the Laplace domain, our step input can be represented as m over s. So what we now need to do is find out what y prime would be, and then once we can subtract these off, we can determine what our offset is. So what we now need to do is we need to find y as a function of s in the Laplace domain, because that can then lead us to finding y at time infinity. So what this requires is we need to do some block diagram algebra to evaluate y over ysp. So if we carry out this block diagram algebra, what we can see is that we can have y. If we go through the loop here, we'll see that y multiplies by gm, goes through further, it'll be gc, gv, gp, and there'll be a minus sign because of the minus that we see here. Then we also have plus ysp multiplied by km, gc, gv, gp. And that, when we come to here, will equal y. So we can rearrange this a bit. We can isolate the y. And then finally, just rearrange a few things to get y over ysp equals km gc gv gp divided by 1 plus gm gc gv gp. So what we'll now do is we'll substitute in the values which we know. So we'll substitute in km. The controller will leave for now. Gv will be kv. Gp will be Kp over tau s plus 1, and we'll have something similar in the denominator. We can further isolate y by moving ysp over, and remembering that ysp is just the step change m over s. Now that we have our value of the transfer function for the output variable, what we can now do is begin to analyze for the different control schemes. So first, we'll start with a P-only control scheme. And there are a number of ways in which we can determine the steady state value of this. The method that we'll use here is we'll take advantage of the final value theorem. So the final value theorem states that the limit of a function, in the time domain as it goes to infinity is equal to the limit of that function in the s domain as s approaches 0 multiplied by s. So here, as for a p-only controller, what that means is that gc will equal kc. And that means that our function will be the limit as s approaches 0 of s multiplied by our function. What we'll notice here is that the s's cancel, and that both tau s plus 1's will go to 1. So therefore, this leaves us with the final value here as m km kc kv kp divided by 1 plus km kc kv kp. As you can see, this value clearly does not equal just m, so that means that we have an offset. So the offset here will be equal to m, what we'd want the value to be, minus this value that we have here, which we can factor out and have 1 minus km kc kv kp divided by 1 plus km kc kv kp. We can do a little bit of simplification here, and that leaves us with our final answer, which can be written as m over 1 plus km kc kv kp, which is often represented as m over 1 plus k sub ol, where k sub ol is the open loop gain, because it represents the gain of the parameters in the open loop. So here what we're showing is that p-only control, although it helps with the speed of a process response and is a little less susceptible to stability issues than other control schemes, a major issue with p-only control is that you'll always have an offset in terms of where your process will operate. So it will not operate at your new set point m. It'll be off by m over 1 plus the open loop gain. And as you can see here, by looking inside this, is as KC, the controller gain goes up, the offset goes down. But there's also a trade-off with that, because as KC goes up, stability problems increase. So the chance that we're having an issue with stability also increases. So there is a give and take there. For part B, we'll do the exact same analysis except for a PI controller. And for a PI controller, our transfer function here is going to be kc times 1 plus 1 over tau is. If we put that into our transfer function analysis that we just did using the same approach as what we did for the p only, we'll have that the limit as t approaches infinity of our function will equal the limit as s approaches 0 of s times our function m over s multiplied by km. The controller transfer function will multiply this by kv and by our process function, and then our denominator will be 1 plus the exact same values we had in the numerator. So before we do any analysis, what we're going to do is simplify our numerator and denominator by finding a least common denominator. So to do that, we're going to first rewrite what's in the parentheses for the I control as tau I s plus 1 over tau I s. Now we will find a least common denominator for the denominator. And now our denominator will have tau is times tau s plus 1 plus km kc kv kp times tau is plus 1 divided by the tau is times tau s plus 1. So what we'll now do is begin some cancellations. What we'll notice here is that our s's cancel out on the front. The denominators of both the numerator and denominator cancel out. What we also see is that the first term in the denominator goes to 0 because of the fact that tau is will equal 0 as s goes to 0. And similarly, the tau is terms will go away for the same reason. So what this leaves us with, after some algebra, is m times km kc kv kp over km kc kv kp, which in fact explicitly cancels, so therefore our limit here is m. Recall that this is the value that we would want to have if we have a change in our set point of magnitude m. We would want our output variable to change by that exact same value. So therefore the PI control does what we would want it to do, as it gives us zero offset. So in this screencast, we have shown how P and PI control respond differently to a process when there is a change in the set point.